of you to our services here this morning to begin our worship. Is this thing working, Jeffrey?
Can you not hear that? Maybe it's all up here. I don't know. We can hear you.
Okay. We do have a couple of announcements as usual. Don't forget we have our Tuesday reading class that will commence as usual. And Wednesday evening, our services here for prayer meeting that we'll been doing next door. And don't forget, this today is our so-called grand opening, if you want to call it that, from next door. And we're going to have our fellowship potluck first in quite a while. And again, we've had lots of people that have been involved next door, so let's enjoy our fellowship together and see if all goes well. I think it will.
All the breakers will blow, right?
Yeah, the breakers should be in good shape. We changed them out, so. I'm going to start our, maybe I'll wait a minute. I'm going to start this morning in our worship hour and read Psalm number 100. Shout with the joy of the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him, sing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pastures. Enter his gate with thanksgiving. Go into the courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and his faithfulness continues to each generation. Thank you, dear Father, for giving us another opportunity to worship you this morning. And we pray, Father, that our attitude and our mind would be right as we listen to the word as it's being proclaimed. And even this afternoon, Father, as we go to have fellowship together, we pray that it may be blessed and that you could be honored in all that we do and say. Always give us, Father, the proper attitude in everything that we do. And we pray, Father, that you would continue to be with us. Help us to be mindful of those that are around us, and help us to be able to spread the love and the joy, not only amongst ourselves, but throughout the community. Be with us as we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. We had a little mud this past week, didn't we? What a huge blessing that was. Huge blessing. Thank you, Lord. Yes, yeah. Sing with joy. Well, how many people always, like we see up here, you know, you got to smile sometimes when you're singing. I'll tell you, I've known Delph for a long time. Yeah, Delph goes, what? I'm going to talk about Delph for just for a second. I've known Delph a long time, and I've never seen anybody more joyful when she sings up there. And you see Delph sing, she's just singing and smiling from ear to ear. I mean, yeah, I just love what you're saying up there, yeah. Amen. Let's stand and sing. We're going to start off with Power in the Blood.
Nobody but a goodie.
Would you be free from a burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. In the precious blood of the Lamb. In the precious.
Thank you.
sound great. We'll end up this with how great is our God.
Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great
I'm not afraid to die.
Great God, we thank you so much for your love, your grace, for your Son, Jesus Christ, that gave it all upon the cross for us, who intercedes for us each and every day. We're so thankful that you're such a loving God and you desire that relationship and you want to hear from us each and every day about our good times, our bad times, what's on our mind. It's just amazing that you desire that from people like us sinners. We just are so thankful. Lord, and we just lift up today and this week to you, Lord, and we just pray that we can bring someone to know you this week. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. If you'll take your scripture this morning, and really I invite you to study God's word as we have gathered this morning corporately in 1 Timothy in chapter 5. How great is our God? What a tremendous statement that we as Christians proclaim from the heart, that there is no God like our God. So this morning, as we just continue in engaging in a time of study, as we have been prepared really through song in the worship of the one true King, that we look at His Word and a continuation of what we looked at last week, and really the honor and the privilege of Scripture this morning, we find ourselves back in the responsibility to minister to widows faithfully in our church. I want to tell you that this can become technical, especially this morning if you're not careful, and we lose the relational aspect of it because there's a lot of information this morning, and it seems almost like a list of do's and don'ts. It's like a baking list. It's like a recipe to build something, and sometimes we lose the flavor of the message because we just look at the technicality and step one, step two, and I don't want to do that, though it's going to be kind of technical. I'm just going to tell you up front, there's a lot of moving pieces, but in order to do that, I just want to say to you that the Apostle Paul has really engaged in dialogue with Timothy, having been left at Ephesus to minister to the people there at Ephesus as their pastor. And up to this point, he's given a lot of doctrinal truths that are based in qualification, warning, the whole flavor of who we are in Christ in the body. And then we looked at last week, he goes from that to what happens when life happens. What happens when life happens in the church, like the loss of a loved one. And you're sitting here this morning, you're a widow or widower. And life was cruising along, and you thought everything was just going to be like this forever, and lo and behold, it's not. What do we do in the life of the church, and how do we respond to that as a body of Christ, in really an honor and glory of who He is in the body and what He brings to the body, but when it happens, how do we operate through that lens? Three things that we're going to see in the next few weeks, and going to finish on widows this morning, and next week we're going to look at elders, and the following week we're going to look at slaves. All of those things are real to the life of the body. What do you do in leadership, and how do you treat the leadership that God has raised up in the body as believers in Christ? What do you do in that relationship that you have a boss at work and it doesn't always go smoothly and it's not always in your favor and sometimes it's demanding of you and sometimes it's difficult for you to line yourself up underneath that authority, and what do you do on those days? Do we just punt and try to get out of the situation and we look for the exit and we just quit? Or do we find ourselves faithful to be who we are in Christ? So this morning we're going to look at two aspects that we did not touch last week. Last week we looked at two of the four that are qualification that we look at when we really peruse Scripture about widows and widowers. And I'm going to say widowers because our society is not like the society in which this was given. Men did have a job. Men did have a means by which they could go on if they lost their wife. And I want to be sensitive to that, though much of what we're going to say this morning is directly to widows, because the culture drives us to know that in the day in which this was written. Some things have changed. Women do have occupations now, and many of them have professions outside of the home. And so a lot of this that we're going to talk about this morning would not be their plight in the day in which we live, but would be their plight in the day in which it was written. Non-education was typical for a woman in this culture. Not having the responsibility of being a caretaker as far as bringing home money and to bring home resources and help sustain the livelihood of the family was not their responsibility. It solely landed on the man. And so much of this is cultural that we're going to look at today. But in the application, I think you can see the application without having to jump too far and make too big a leap. Guys, the bottom line is this is really an imperative. And it comes to us an instruction of correction, meaning that they were not doing like they should have been doing in regards to widows. And so Paul says to Timothy, we need to set these things straight, much like he told Titus to the churches at Crete. There's some things going on that shouldn't go on. Fix it. Last week, specifically, it was to the body of Christ and the widow in the congregation who is a born-again believer. This morning, it's going to cause us to come to a place of discernment. There is a category this morning that widows that find themselves in a state of carnality if they're a believer, or they're not a believer at all and they're acting in their evil flesh. Does a body just throw money at and resource at everything, or do we have to show ourselves to be prudent and to be good stewards of God's money that he's impressed upon us to bring to the storehouse? The answer to that is yes, we need to be prudent and discerning. Well, Paul doesn't leave this without explanation. He says there is a category in a widow's life who lives a life of carnality or in foolishness, having been left without a husband. Here's how you're going to identify it, and here's what you're going to do about it. But he leaves it this morning back to the widows indeed of who makes the list. Guys, it's beautiful in Scripture. You can hardly do this without crying. But some of the greatest influences in my life as a pastor has been widows. Say, oh, Rob. No, I'm being serious. Some of the most precious moments for me in the ministry has been in the home of, or by the bed of, or in corporate worship like this amongst widows. Champion for the faith when all of life seems like it's against them. Faithful to the end. Even though life has punched them a hard blow. Just a statue of that in my mind, of structure, of stability, will always be encouraging to me. I'm with Ken. I can't hardly watch Delpha worship, not because it's ugly, because it almost makes me tear up. How can loss have that kind of non-effect when it comes to worshiping the King? Guys, this is real life. We get so technical and so sometimes religious and so theological, and all that stuff is fine, but sometimes we just need to get in the weeds and look at life for what it really is. How then shall we live in lieu of this? Two things this morning, and I want to just refer back to what we've already looked at in Scripture. And last week we looked at widows indeed, and if you were not here, you're taking notes again this morning, just as a refresher, it's chapter 5, beginning in verse 3, 5, and the end of 16b. And I'm going to go back and look at that in just a minute as we get to those fourth in the category. And secondly, we looked at widows with living relatives. That's verse 4, verse 8, and the first part of 16, 16a. This morning we're going to kick it off is, if you will, and permit me to do so, a call to discernment in the third of the category of widows who live carnal lives. It begins in verse 6. If you have your Bible open now to chapter 5 of 1 Timothy, it goes into verse 6, and then we're going to drop down to verse 11 and go through verse 15. Father, we just ask that as we enter into this time of worship through really the teaching of the Word, that we come to a place of understanding and total confession of dependency on you. Father, we cannot understand this. We cannot grasp this. We can't even apply this in a right way unless you teach us today. So in your sovereign grace, knowing that this is a reality of this body and it will continue to be a reality till you come again, that we are found faithful as the body of the living Christ, that we would practice piety and learn to do good in lieu of widows. We love you. We thank you. We're honored today to be here. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Beginning in verse 6, it really reflects back to what we looked at as the overarching theme in verse 3. It says, honor widows. Honor, you remember, is a technical term that means to put a price on or put a value on. It's a worth value. Widows are to be looked at and they're to be appreciated and they're really to be handled like fragile beings in this state of loss. But it's through the lens of honor. It's to put a premium price on a widow that is truly a widow indeed. We looked at that in just the overarching understanding of how we treat widows. The Apostle Paul knows there's going to be some difficulty in the community at Ephesus when doing this. So the very first thing we're going to look at this morning is in those third categories of widows is the carnality of life that sometimes is expressed in the loss of life of a husband and a wife. Look at it beginning in verse 6. He's going to lay out really a definition of lostness and what that looks like in this time of loss. But that but is in contrast to verse 5. So it's important that I read verse 5 in order to get to the contrast in verse 6. Now she is a widow indeed, and who has been left alone, has fixed her hope on God and continues in entreaties and prayers night and day. There's a position and an attitude of the heart for a widow indeed who will find herself in a place of entrustment to the God who saved her. A hope that is not just circumstantial about this life. I know that this is a difficult state that I'm in. I know that this is a reality that I must deal with. But I have turned my focus and my affection to the hope of God and the glory of Christ in me. And it is expressed in the fact that I'm a prayer warrior. Entreaties and prayers, I take the petitions of myself and I take the positions of the community of faith to the throne of grace, and I know that God hears my cry, and I want to be found faithful, making entreaty and supplication and prayers, not just when it's most convenient for me. Look at the text, day and night. That's a continual state, constantly. When they're impressed upon to go to the throne of grace, they're faithful to do so. And I told you last week, some of the greatest ministers in the church are widowers and widows that are absolute prayer warriors for the body of Christ. There is none greater in the body to be raised up. And Paul makes this initial understanding in verse 5. This is their character. This is their life. This is what they do. Well, look at verse 6. But in contrast, there's a reality out there that is not always a prayer warrior and doesn't always fix their hope in the person of Jesus Christ. Verse 6 says this, there's those in the community, but she who gives herself to wanton pleasure is dead even while she lives. Who gives herself to wanton pleasure? Now, I want to tell you, this is a lifestyle. This is not just a moment in time. This is characterization of this is what they're about in their life. wanton pleasure. Let me just show you a couple of verses that kind of go along with this, just so that you see that this is not the only place that this is found. James, the half-brother of Jesus, also speaks about this wanton pleasure. Go to James in chapter 5 in verse 5, and really it's the context is the misuse of riches. God has granted to you the abundance of harvest, and he has given you an expression of that abundancy, and there's some wealth that's come with it, but you're misusing it. Look at verse 5 of chapter 5 of James. You have lived luxuriously on the earth and led a life of wanton pleasure. You have fattened your hearts in a day of slaughter. There's a judgment for you that awaits you. Wanton pleasure. And I'm going to show you in Scripture what that looks like. Go to Luke, and Jesus is going to give us a story of the prodigal son. Luke chapter 15. If you'll just skate over there with me. The very first part of this beautiful story, really, of God's amazing grace and salvation. But it begins this way in Luke chapter 15, drop down to verse 13. The definition is wanton pleasure. Go up to verse 11 because it sets the stage. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me. And he divided his wealth between them. Now listen to verse 13. And not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together and went on a journey into the distant country. In and of himself, there's nothing wrong with that to this point. Look at the end of the verse. The scripture says that he squandered his estate with what? Wanton pleasure, loose living. Technically, in this scripture that we're looking at this morning and in this passage out of the book of Luke, it has a sexual depravity, has an evil sexual position in it. We know that in this, there's a desire that happens within all people. And we get to this place in verse 6, and we see that oftentimes a widow will find themselves in carnality, but in this case, in wanton pleasure that really defines themselves as a lost person. You see that at the end? She's dead already. That means that she is separated from the love of God. She is not a true believer. We have to be careful that whenever we start aiding and assisting in the body, that we know these things up front. What is the lifestyle? What is the characteristic? Is it wanton pleasure? Is it to defame the character of our Lord? We have to be a discerning mind with a fixed spirit that I want to do as unto God what God wants me to do as unto the resources that he has abundantly given us. We see that misuse of treasure or resource in James. We see that widows oftentimes fall into this category. But what about those who are just carnal in their walk? Well, that's the lost. There's a warning there. There's a discernment call. But look, beginning in verse 11, the scripture now begins to lay out this passage in clarity. Verse 11, but again, in contrast, so go back up to the beginning, or I'm just going to pick it up in 10. It actually goes back to 9, and we're going to actually deal with 9 and 10. Having a reputation of good works, and if she has brought up children, if she has shown hospitality to strangers, if she has washed the saints' feet, if she has assisted those in distress, and if she has devoted herself to every good work. But refuse, that's to deny, that's to not engage in, but refuse to put younger widows on the list. We're going to see that in verse 9, there's a list. What does that list look like, and what is the purpose of the list? The purpose of the list is a widow indeed. Now, let's redefine what a widow indeed is. One who does not have family that can take care of her, and she falls sorely and strictly under the authority of the Bible according to the church, and she then becomes our obligation, not in stress and not in a position of, I can't believe we're having to take care of her. That is not the purpose of this passage. You remember that? We get to honor God in honoring this widow indeed. Where does charity first begin according to Scripture? in the family. Well, we dealt with that last week, but let's just say we have no family. We don't have a place to go, and we're a widow indeed. We don't have resources. Guess what? Bingo, we're it. We're tagged. Good for us, right? Hallelujah. We get an opportunity to honor God by serving somebody else like a widow. All right, but the contrast is there is one you do not put on the list. Why? Guys, if Paul would have just left this, this is why the call of discernment has to be anchored in the Bible. It's not because I don't like her, because she said some mean things to me. It's not because she's not of my color, my race, my creed, my religion. No. There's a reason why. And I want you to see it. He says, but refuse to put younger widows on the list. He's already identified who they are by age. Younger. I want to show you why. For when they feel sensual desires in disregard of Christ, they want to get married. When their focus turns from the hope that is in Christ Jesus, and they've given themselves day and night to prayer, they still have a desire for accompaniment, and they want to be found in union with a man. Guys, there's nothing wrong with that, but we don't go slap them on the list. They just need to get married. Paul says in 1 Corinthians, that's exactly what I'm asking them to do, beginning in chapter 7 and verse 39. If you have a woman who is not going to give herself to those things that are accompanied with just the prayer meeting, and that's satisfactory, and the things that are ministry, and that's satisfactory, if they want to get married, they have sensual desires, by all means, don't squelch that. Don't put them on the list. Let them get married. Go find you a godly man. He'll take care of you. Well, so the first thing we see is don't put a young woman, a young widow on the list. They have desires that they want companionship. Let them go seek companionship in another man. Well, it changes just a little for when they feel sensual desires. And it doesn't mean in disregard of Christ as though they're lost their salvation or walking away. It just means that they have a focus that is not going to be just serving the church. They want to have a home and a household and a husband. In disregard to that, they want to get married. Now look at this. Incurring condemnation because they have set aside their previous pledge. All right, so this is interesting, and I told you that part of this is set in culture, is set in society. Here's what would happen in the local community: a young woman loses her husband to death. Oftentimes, in Levitical law, here's what that young widow would do. She would give herself to the temple. In our case, she would give herself to the church. And she would say, I promise, or I make a pledge to you that I will serve the body, and I will not try to go, and I will not try to remarry, and all my affection and all my desire and all my time is going to be given to the service of the church. Does that sound like anybody in Scripture in the life of Christ? How about Anna? Yeah. He goes for a circumcision, and guess who? One of the ministers, one of the servants in the body of Christ that's waiting for him and has anticipated the coming of the Messiah is this prophetess or this lady who has given herself to really just attaching herself to the body and serving the body. She's not looking for a husband. She don't want one. And so this lady has made a pledge. And the local pastor says, okay, well, there's some things you can do, and we'll make sure that we take care of you. And all of a sudden she says, I won't be there tomorrow. Or she doesn't tell us, and she doesn't clock in. Well, what do I do? Well, where is she? I don't know. She didn't show up. Well, didn't she say she'd show up? Yeah. Well, that's kind of condemning because now she's speaking against her pledge to this body. He says, don't put her on a list. Don't do that. Don't suffer her and don't suffer the body by doing that. You are enabling her, and now it is a condemnation to her. Don't cause that pledge to cause a stumble both for the body and for her. She needs to get married. Well, check this out. The scripture says, look at verse 13, and at the same time, they also learn to be idle. So if we put them on the list and they shouldn't be on the list, guess what? There's a result. There's a root cause that causes an ungodly effect. Idleness is not good for a widow. It's not good for a widower. It's not good for this fat guy either. You must be busy about something that is godly in your life. There must be a daily pursuit of activity or we become idle. And look at the fruit that comes from idleness in this widow's life. You say, well, Robbie, it's not that big a deal, right? You remember I told you that some of the greatest influences on my life were widows? Some of the most damaging were widows. Every coffee shop, every bridge game, every domino event, we're there, baby. And look what idleness brings to the table. He says, don't put this on the list. Don't put them on the list. This is incurring condemnation because they've set aside their previous pledge, and at the same time, they learn. That is a habitual process. As they practice it, they learn more and more, and it's refined in condemnation. It's refined in evil. They do not stay the same. It is progressive regression. They learn better and more and better and more about what? Look at it with me. To be idle, they go around from house to house. They have so much time on their hand, they can check out what the neighbor's doing. How? They're at the neighbor's house. It's gone from, I'm looking through the curtains, now I'm the one at the house, and I'm figuring out everything that's happening in your home as well as mine. And we just journey from house to house, but look, it gets deeper. And he says they go around from house to house, and not merely idle, that's not enough, but also gossips. They take partial truth and they embellish it. And it's always from the reflection that it's damaging to the one they're speaking about. Or the situation that we don't know fully, but we're going to add anything we don't know with my little caveat, gossip. But it doesn't stop there. They become busybodies. They get in everybody else's business and they have an opinion and a position on your task in life. I wouldn't do that if I were you. This is what I'd do. And the minute they have opportunity, they talk about it outside of that circle that you're in. Gossips, busybodies. Talking about things not proper to mention. Guys, in any other setting, you would never say this stuff. Improper means it has no place of purity. It's impure thought that leads to impure conversation. They talk about these things that are not okay for believers to talk about. Verse 14. Therefore, I want younger widows to get married. He just comes right out and says it. Here's what I want them to do. Okay, you want to stop the idleness? You want to stop the busybody? You want to stop the gossip? You want to stop the house to house? You want to stop the improper conversations that we're having? I'm going to tell you how. Now look at what he says for them to do. Get married. But here's what they do in marriage. Bear children. Keep house. And give the enemy no occasion for reproach. All right, this is interesting because we just think it's just get married. Look at the fruit that breaks idleness and it smashes this ill will and gossip and being a busybody. Not only do we get married, but there's some things we do in our marriage to see to it that we are a godly person. I get married, and the first thing I'm going to do is to bear children. That literally means to bear children means I'm going to train the offspring in this new relationship. I'm not just going to have them. That's a biological event. It has to go past that. So my affection now is not going to be idle anymore. I'm going to pour my affection and my time and my resources in raising up the children that God has given me as a treasure to live as unto Christ, bear children. It does not say have children. Bearing means that learning of idolatry and idleness now becomes a learning of instruction to my own children. Wow, what a beautiful picture in God's Word. Secondly, it says, not only do I want you to bear children, I want you to keep house. That is more than cleaning your home. Get out of that mindset. Does that mean cleaning your home? Yes. You would say, well, Rob said that doesn't mean that. Rob didn't say that. That is not all inclusive to having a household and working diligently in your home. That means you manage the affairs of your home well. There is a schedule. There is a blessedness in your home that is really rooted in and fruited in you being who you are in Christ in the home. Guys, I've told you this a million times, but this is the truth. If I can get home at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what happened to me during the day. If I can just get home, I'm good. Why? Because I get to come home to my wife. And it's not burdensome, and it's not heavy, and it's not a yoke. Because I know that there's some essential elements to that relationship that I desire above even my job, believe it or not, in our society of overwork. And the Apostle Paul looks at Timothy and says, don't put them on the list. I want to tell you what to do with them. Tell them to get married. And train up children in a godly way. And manage their households well. Guys, I've never missed a meal. And you can see that. If I missed a meal, it's because I chose to. And I've not chosen to miss many. I never really worry about how the home is going to run from an aspect of, you know, what we're going to do and what we're going to eat. Sometimes when people say, what do you want to have tonight? And I'll weigh in on, that doesn't mean that's what we're going to have. She just gave me the right to say what I wanted. Because we've had one bad meal in 36 years of marriage, and I cooked it. It was nasty. I mean, I even looked at it and went, oh, man, our poor dog. He's not even going to be okay. And when I look at this, the management of a household, and I look at keeping house, guys, if it's just about washing clothes and doing the dishes, man, hire somebody. It's way past that. Because I'm going to tell you, number one, my kids are safe at home. Guys, forget me for a minute, because it's not about me. I knew my children were safe with my wife. I knew the instruction was right. I knew the love was pure. I knew her motive was right. I never had to worry about it. If mom has them, somehow they're in danger. If they were in danger, it's because of some outside entity or some circumstance outside of her. It wasn't because of her. Folks, that's how you keep house. That's what it is to keep house. If you ever come to our house and it's dirty, forgive us. But I'm going to tell you, it's relationally, it's okay. A dirty house is not a reflection of a poor Christian or a bad steward. It's what happens when the home is in operation. Is it godly? Is it pure? Is it right? But lastly, it says, not only getting married, bear children, keep house. He says, I want you to be above reproach. Let no evil be said of you that is found in truth. That's what being above reproach is. Though it may be said of you, it's not founded in truth. You're above even those things that are spoken in slander against you. He says, don't put those young women on the list. In verse 6, don't put those lost that have wanton pleasure. Don't put them on the list. And don't put those young Christian women on the list. It'd be best if they got married. If they give themselves to the service of the church, you take that. But don't be surprised if they come to you and say, I quit. It's okay. Get married. Verse 15. For some have already turned aside to follow Satan. Some, this circumstance exposed their true heart. The circumstance of life was so heavy and so burdensome that they really showed to the community of faith who they really were. They were never of us. Therefore, they acted in response to evil, to satanic being. Oh, okay, let's leave that alone. What about that widow indeed? Man, this is good. This is one of the prettiest places. I know that there are places in Isaiah and in Proverbs and in the Psalms that leave this beautiful definition and beautiful picture of a woman who is godly and heavily in pursuit of Jesus Christ. But man, not any prettier than this. Beginning in verse 9 through verse 10 is the last of four categories. Widows who are on, quote, the list for church support. Widows indeed, they don't have family. They're in right standing with the body. They are a true born-again believer. They're not young. Their pledge is, I will follow hard after hope in Jesus Christ. What about that woman? Take care of her. Honor her. Look in verse 9. Let a widow be put on the list only if she is not less than 60 years old, having been the wife of one man. All right, you say, Rob, are we going to get hung up on that 60? No, Levitical law, that was Old Testament law. 60 was that age of maturity, or the age of retirement. If we had a 59-year-old that needed, as a widow indeed, the aid and assistance of the body, we're going to take care of her. But in the culture in which this was written, 60 years old was that transition year from being a young widow in need and an older widow in need. And I just want to tell you, I'm not going to get hung up on that. If you're 58 or whatever, and you're a widow indeed, we'll take care of you. Having been the wife of one man. Now, we saw this earlier in chapter 3, verse 2, and chapter 3, verse 12, in responsibility and qualifications of an elder and a deacon. A one-woman man. Now we flip it, a one-man woman. This lady was given to her husband. She was devoted to her husband and her husband alone. She's less than, she's over 60 years old, which we're not going to die on that hill, but she was in a relationship with her husband, and it was fruitful, and it was absolutely God-honoring. First step. Having a reputation for good works. There's eight of these essentials, by the way. Having a reputation of good works is those who speak well of her. The reputation is not self-proclaimed. I want you to see the way it's written in the original text. It's not that they stand out on the front porch and say, I'm a woman of good reputation, take care of me. It's not we go down and fill out an application and you get to say who you are on this application. You get to profile and bio your own life. And at the end of it, you say, well, bingo, I'm of good reputation. Take care of me. No. This is a community at large, not only the church, but the community at large. Look upon this woman, and she's of mature age, and she was in a devoted, healthy relationship with her husband before suffering loss, and now, when you speak of her in the common places of gathering, it is always of good reputation. Her testimony precedes whatever else is about her. Her testimony is right in Christ. But he goes on. He says, if shown of good works, and if she has brought up children. You see that little if? For the next few of these, there's five good works. You see the end of a good reputation for good works? The Apostle Paul is going to define in five ways what good works are. We don't even have to worry about that. That's how good the Bible is. He says, you want a definition of what good works is? I'm going to give you five characteristics, five definitions of good work. You see that if? That's a first-class conditional if. You can exchange that for since. This is her character. We're not having to debate this. We're not having to put it on the measure of balance and say, well, on this she's pretty good. On this she's not all that good. This is a sense value. This is absolutely who she is. And how do we know that? Look at it. If she has brought up children. You see that little caveat about the young woman getting married? Remember how we break idleness? Bear children. Guess what brought children up means? Same thing. When I look at her children, I see mom in them, and she's above reproach. She's of good reputation. Are they perfect? Heavens no. Neither is the mother, neither is this pastor. But if I just look at the panoramic view, the dynamics of her character, I can see that reflected in since she raised up and brought up her children in a godly way, I see their mother in them. Guys, there is nothing, there are some things that are equal to, but there's nothing greater in humanity than for somebody to come and say, I caught your kid doing well and it reminds me of their mother. Wow, what a testimony. I've known their mother since she was a little girl, and when she started having kids, they just looked just like her. They posture like her, they walk like her, they talk like her, they live like her. Well, how was that? Above repute, of good reputation. What a legacy to leave for your family than the offspring of a diligent, godly mother. Guys, there is no greater calling for a woman than to be a mama. Second to that is to be a grandma. You can send them home when they act like their dad. He says, here's one of good works. A one-man woman devoted to her husband. And when you look at those kids, they were brought up right in Christ. If she's that, put her on the list. Oh, but he didn't leave it at that. Check this out. And he says, but I'm going to go even further. That good works is brought up in children, is shown hospitality to strangers. That doesn't mean that she is derelict with her home. This is also in culture of the time. There was not a Motel 6 that was going to leave the light on for you when you entered into Ephesus. There were people in the square that she would have really interfaced with as she's buying groceries and exchanging those made wares that she's taking to the market. And they didn't have a place to stay, and they didn't have a place to go eat that night. And she would say, well, what are you doing for dinner tonight? And they'd say, well, I don't know, we're just passing through. Why don't you stop by and have dinner? I'll make a meal. Guys, I've told you this too. I can't remember a time in my teenage years there was not an empty plate at our table and somebody occupied it, and most of the time I didn't know who they were. My mom brought home every derelict at school. Every little kid that was snotty-nosed and needed a bath were sitting at our table. Guys, it means something in the kingdom. They brought up their children well, and they extended hospitality to even people who were not their own, strangers. It doesn't mean strange. It means stranger. They're not family. They're not my neighbor. They just need a hand, and I'm going to offer it to them. But then he says this. Hospitality to strangers, brought up children, and if she has washed the saints' feet. All right, let's don't get crazy. You say, well, Rob, of all those widows that really imparted encouragement to you and became really stability in your life, did they ever wash your feet? Not one of them. Physically took my shoes off and my socks and never put my feet in water and dried them off with a towel. Not one time. But they washed my feet every single time I was with them. Guys, you know how many times I would go visit a widow? thinking that I was going to give something to that moment. I was going to go minister to them, and I walked away jazzed in Christ because of them. More encouraged than whenever I went to try to encourage. I walked away going, man, it was good to go see her today. I needed that. That's washing. That's servanthood. That's what true slavery to Christ looks like. What do you mean, Rob? This is the lowest form of service in the community that Paul was writing this in. Let me tell you how nasty this was. Just go back to John chapter 13 and you'll see what Christ did less than 24 hours before he was killed for the sins of men. You know what this widow indeed does? She'll do the most difficult deeds in service that nobody else will take. Those strangers that you showed hospitality to, they had walked all day long, maybe days long, through the highways and byways of those communities in open-toed shoes, sandals. And they entered into your home, and before they sat at your table, they reclined on the floor in this culture to eat a meal. You were really in proximity, close to somebody's feet when you were eating. Guess what this lady would do in her home? She would meet you at the door with a wash basin and a rinse basin. And even if she had to pull the tunic off of her own gown, she would restore your feet to cleanliness, having been dealt filthy roads and byways. He said, this lady, this is what good works looks like. She was devoted to her own husband. She brought up her children in a godly way. She was hospitable to strangers. And when they entered her home, she washed their feet. And specifically, he says to the saints. That means she served in sometimes the lowliest ways in the body of Christ. But he ends it with this. And as if she has assisted those in distress, this is a term for benevolent care. Here she is wanton in difficult and strange life, having been married at a point of time in health and devotion to a husband. She's reared her children well. Her reputation is above reproach in the community. She is hospitable to strangers and she'll wash the saints' feet. But then she will gaze across the community of faith and she will see somebody that is hurting and in need and stressed out because of their plight in life. And she'll go take care of it. Guys, I don't know how many times, just like you and just your church life, you've seen a widow or a widower carrying food to a meal for a funeral, to a wedding, to a baby shower. Not all those are distress, but some of them are. And instead of looking inward, they serve outward because that's what Christ does to us, in us, and through us. She is motivated to meet the needs of those in distress. And then I think Paul just ran out of things to say, and he just made a cornucopia of everything else she is. Look at the end of verse 10. And she has devoted herself to every good work. And whatever else there is, she's just good at it. And since she is, here's what I want you to do, Timothy. Survey the congregation at Ephesus. If you find one of these, put her on the list. Take care of her. That's a trophy of God's grace to the body of Christ. Because she's fixed her hope in Jesus Christ. In day and night, she intercedes for the body and herself. And she is above reproach. And she does good works, devoted to her husband, above reputation in testimony. Oh, and by the way, her kids look like her. And they act like God. And when a stranger's in need, she extends a hand of hospitality. Oh, and by the way, if you're ever in distress, she's the one you want ministering to you. Why? Because she'll wash your feet. And anything else that's good, she'll sign up. That's who she is. And guys, I know every single one of you in this auditorium this morning can picture one face that you say, I know her. I know who she is. I know that lady. Rob, are you telling me that as one of the elders, if I came to you and I said, Rob, this is a lady that needs help, that we would disregard that request? No, we would put it under the litmus of Scripture. And if that's that lady, we'll take care of her. Because if charity begins with the widows that have family, and it begins in the family, then charity for those widows indeed begins in the body of Christ, not government, not social interaction. Let it never be said of us that we did not take care of our own. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the provision of grace that we find in it. And Father, for these passages that just seem like we'll just read through these and get through them. What a beautiful picture of those things in warning that we are not supposed to be engaged in, and those things that we are to embrace wholeheartedly as a gift from you to honor and glorify all that you are and all that you've said. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Rob. Growing up in Ballinger, I've known a lot of ladies like that up there. Tell you what, good, great memories, like you said. Awesome. All right, we're going to end. You'll stand and sing with us on our closing. We're going to sing, You Are My King. My joy to honor you.
tears.